Dr. Zsófia Clemens is a neurobiologist, and she's the director of the International Center for Medical Nutritional Intervention, which was formerly known as Paleomedicina. This is the only clinic in the world right now treating patients with a plant-free diet, and so we are so excited to hear the experience that she can bring for us. So please welcome Dr. Clemens.
I would like to thank Amber for the invitation, and I'm very honored to be here. My presentation will cover intestinal permeability and the related issues. So, first of all, what is the intestinal permeability? The intestinal permeability is, first of all, a membrane-related issue, phenomenon, and membranes have two basic functions, and one of it is separating, and the other one is connecting different spaces within our body, also within single cells, and also within the single cells within single organelles. So membranes can be found throughout the body at different levels, and they are very basic in determining many functions, physiological functions of the body. Due to this dual function, connecting and separating at the same time, membranes possess a characteristic which is called selective permeability. So they are not just permeable or non-permeable, they are selectively permeable. And this function is brought about by cell junction structures. And the most important and well-known structure is a tight junction. And the tight junctions are responding to a variety of food stimuli from our diet. They are also responding to a variety of inflammation mediators in the body and also influenced by the pathogens. These tight junctions are also highly dynamic. They can change their function from 1 hour to another or even within a less space of time. And very importantly, tight junctions are modulated by a protein which is called zonulin, which has been described by Alessio Fasano in 2000 as a big contribution to the field. The next question is about what is the relationship between intestinal permeability and the autoimmune disease, and what we know for sure that there is an association between the two, because elevated intestinal permeability has been described for a variety of autoimmune conditions, including Crohn's disease, type 1 diabetes, rheumatoid arthritis, autism, and many more. What we also know is that there is a gradual association, which means that, for example, in Crohn's disease, more severe Crohn's cases are associated with a higher level of intestinal permeability. But as we know, correlative studies do not allow for a distinction between cause and an effect. And therefore, there has been a long discussion, speculations about which comes first, whether intestinal permeability is resulting in the autoimmune disease or the other way around. So there was no way to establish this because only interventional studies are able to provide cue to this, but so far all the interventional studies that have been carried out failed in normalizing intestinal permeability. Here you can see the failed attempts to normalize intestinal permeability. They include probiotics, prebiotics, fecal transplantation as well, and there are some dietary interventions. In the list, you can see the paleo diet, because in 2014, we had this study with, this was an interventional study with a paleo diet, which is actually a regular or a popular version of the paleo diet, which is also containing large amounts of vegetables, fruits, nuts, and vegetable oils. So this was a diet they used in this study. And as in all previous studies with the paleo diet, that they found that the paleo diet is beneficial in weight control, controlling glucose levels, and many metabolic parameters, but this diet was not able to normalize the intestinal permeability, nor it was able to decrease inflammation level in the body. There is a study from 2013 which asked the question whether it is time to treat intestinal permeability, because we already know so much about intestinal permeability. Big data from animal research, cell-based research, and so on. We just do not know how to normalize it. And it is important because it has been hypothesized in this article and many more articles that restoring the intestinal permeability would be the cure, would be the key to cure autoimmune diseases. How do we measure intestinal permeability? So these are the tests that have been used in humans, including clinical practice as well as clinical studies. First, we have the zonulin. First, we have the zonulin, which is the most well-known measure. Here, you can also see the advantages and disadvantages. So the major disadvantage of the zonulin test is that it is actually not a measurement, unlike any other measurements. This is a marker. And second, it is not a specific marker of intestinal permeability. Rather, it is an overall marker of membrane permeability overall in our body. But anyway, it is very easy to perform it because it is just a simple laboratory test. Then we have the lactulose monitor test, which is a so-called differential sugar absorption test, which means that the patient has to ingest a solution of two different sugars, and one of the sugars is an absorbing sugar and the other one is a non-absorbing, at least non-absorbing under normal conditions. And the ratio of the two as excreted in the urine is calculated to determine intestinal permeability. The major disadvantage is these sugars interact with food items, bind to serum proteins, and are degraded by the intestinal bacteria. So the end result is not very reliable. Then we have the sucralose test, which is also associated with the same disadvantages. And here we have two radioactive tests, like the eohexol, which has been widely used 20 years ago. The major disadvantage is the radioactivity itself. So dealing with radioactive compounds always posing technical challenges. But at least they are not binding to serum proteins. Then we have the last one, the PEC-400 test, which is associated with most advantages and the least disadvantages. And this is the test that we are also using. So what is a PEC-400 test? It is a compound that is non-toxic, inert. It is not degraded by intestinal bacteria, and the testing itself does not depend on the laboratory. So the patient can do the testing at home, and then, of course, the measurement is relying on the laboratory. But from the practical point of view, this is a huge advantage. Actually, it only has one disadvantage, and it is that the measurement is affected by the kidney function. So if there are problems with the membrane permeability within the kidney, then the end result may be affected. The PEC-400 is containing a mixture of at least 11 different sizes of this PEG molecule. And the mixture that has to be drunk is containing 3 grams of the PEG. And there is a 6-hour urine collection. And the percentage of each fraction of the PEG excreted over 6 hours is calculated.
Is that test available to mere mortals?
To what?
Is that test available to every person?
Yes, of course.
In the United States?
No, only with our laboratory, but as I told you, the test can be sent through post, just a simple surface email. So,
thank you.
I can send it if you want. So this is how the measurement result look like. So here we have the fractions with different molecular sizes. These are two measurements. And here you can see the percentage of the excretion in the urine as compared to the original amount of the PEG. And with the dotted lines, you can see the normal range indicated, lower and upper level. And here are the individual measurements for the specific fractions. But anyway, this was the first study when we have managed to provide direct evidence that we normalize intestinal permeability in a patient with a Crohn's disease. And this is actually the first study in the whole literature with intestinal permeability being reversed.
Before you, forgive me, when you say PKD, you mean your version of paleo keto, meaning no vegetables, nothing but meat, and very specific, not the paleo mentioned earlier in the slide that allows them, right?
Yes, I will come back to this later, but actually it is a diet which is also paleolithic in the original sense of the word, meaning that it is based on animal meat and fat, and also ketogenic, so ensures energy from ketones or fats. So we do had many patients with Crohn's disease before who had normalized their condition, but this was the first Crohn's disease patient in whom intestinal permeability was measured. And here you can see the first measurement. This was done at 4 months on the PKD. And at this time, the patient still had gastrointestinal symptoms, slightly elevated inflammatory marker levels, and overall less than optimal blood work. And this has happened at 10 months. You can see that the intestinal permeability went back to the normal range. And at this time, the patient was already completely, completely symptom-free, had normalized inflammatory levels, and his ultrasound for the first time came back negative.
What's the x-axis?
X-axis? The weight.
Particle size?
These are the molecular weights, and this is the percentage of the recovery in the urine. So to have a broader picture of the background, the clinical background, so this has happened before. This patient has been taking several medicines, medical combinations between 2013 and 2015. Here you can see the duration of the medications taken, and she took everything that is possible to having Crohn's disease. At the end, she also used formula feeding, but actually at the time point, it was not possible to control for the pain, for the inflammation, and surgery was decided on the part of his physicians. And this was also the point where he decided to start a PKD in order to prevent and avoid surgery. And as you can see, here are the inflammation levels, CRP, ESR, and the both went back to quite low levels. And so this is the published part of the study, and we are often asked what has happened next. So a little bit of a follow-up. We now have a 3 years follow-up, and as you can see, inflammation levels are far lowered as compared to the previous follow-up. The patient is still completely seizure symptom-free and consistently has a normal ultrasound. What is happening from outside? This is another patient also with a Crohn's disease. So this is the transition in pictures. This has happened in 11 months. So these are the collaborations for the intestinal permeability measurements. We have been measuring it in patients since 2015, and first we had a collaboration with the Biolab London, and we still have this collaboration, but at a certain point we decided to further the methodology and also wanted to further the methodology and application areas, including the measurement of other membranes. So we started another collaboration in addition with the Technical University of Budapest, Hungary. But unfortunately, last year, the leader of the group, Dr. Peter Merész, passed away And that's why we had to build a new collaboration. And the new collaboration is now with the University of Debrecen Department of Applied Chemistry. This is just a little background that we now have three sets of data for the measurements, and they are not necessarily can be lumped together because of the methodological differences behind. So this is for the first set of data. Each line is corresponding a single measurement. Here you can see the normal ranges, and we can do comparisons. First of all, here we have the measurements done for those patients who have been following PKD and other diets. And just as something interesting, in the other any other diet group, the highest intestinal permeability is corresponding to a patient who has been following a popular version of the paleo diet, which is generally regarded as being healthy. Then we break down the PKD group further according to diet duration. Here we have those who have been doing PKD for less than a week. Here, those who have been doing it for more than a month. And the difference is more salient, as you can see. And in the next step, we broke down this group. And here is what we have. So here we have the normal intestinal permeability group and the elevated one, and looked at the difference. And it turned out that all patients that had normal intestinal permeability have been doing the PKD as a standalone therapy. So no medicines, no chemotherapy, no supplements. And here we do have a patient who had been doing PKD along with a biological therapy. This is a patient who had also been consuming alcohol on a regular basis, and this is just a not adherent patient. And we do have this pattern across the two other sets of measurements. Okay, let's move forward toward the transitional studies. So these are actually interventional studies, before after measurements. Here we have three healthy control persons. Two have been following a standard Western type diet and then moved toward the PKD. This subject had been following a popular paleo diet and then PKD. As you can see, the first measurement is elevated in all three cases in red. And then we have a second measurement at 3 or 4 weeks of the diet. And as you can see, in all three cases, intestinal permeability went back to normal. And in this subject, we also have a third measurement. This was done at 1 year of the PKD. And as you can see, intestinal permeability further decreased. We have the same comparison for patients. Here we have a patient with Hodgkin lymphoma who had been using the classical version of the ketogenic diet. In addition, he has been taking 10 sorts of supplements, and he was also over several cycles of chemotherapy and a huge intestinal permeability. And in 4 months, we did see that intestinal permeability decreased significantly, but we still have somewhat elevated intestinal permeability for the middle molecules here. And this is something we frequently see in those patients who underwent chemotherapy before. Another patient, ovarian cancer, first measurement, then the second measurement, then the third measurement. So what we see is that on the PKD, intestinal permeability lowered but still elevated, and this is pointing to the fact that the chemotherapy is doing maybe doing harm that may not be reversed, or mainly may only be reversed in a longer time. And this is also supported from studies in the literature showing that chemotherapy is contributing to the intestinal permeability. And then we have an epilepsy patient who became first seizure-free and then again started having seizures, and adherence issues were suspected. So therefore, she was asked to come to our clinical retreat where she was under our close control. And this was the first measurement upon arrival. And just in 2 days, intestinal permeability normalized, and she was completely seizure-free during this period. Otherwise, she had daily seizures. Why do we use intestinal permeability? First, in order to monitor dietary adherence, and this is an important issue in children because adherence is very tricky in children. Then we can monitor the course of the disease, where is the disease going, what is the pattern behind, and we can also monitor the effectivity of the PKD, but of course we can monitor the effectivity of any other diet. Cancer. What we do see that normal intestinal permeability in patients is associated with low inflammation level. And we also see that both are associated with a better outlook in terms of survival or progression-free survival. Here we have a patient with a glioblastoma, which is a grade 4 brain cancer. Now the patient is progression-free, so not just alive, but completely progression-free for the last 30 months. Otherwise, survival, average of the survival is not 53. Average survival is not more than 6 months in the case of glioblastoma. And here we have a normal intestinal permeability. Here we have a normal blood work measured in time with quite low inflammation level. And here we can see the follow-up MRIs for the patient, so no change in the size of the tumor across the 30 months. And then just some more, some interesting data showing that in those who are eating in a similar way, like this couple, wife and husband, there are similar curves for the intestinal permeability. This was done at the first day of their both PKD diet. And it is elevated to a similar level despite of the fact that one is a patient and another one is a healthy person. Okay. Then another interesting measurement exemplifying that only a meat or meat-fed diet is able to completely normalize intestinal permeability. And patients, especially worrisome patients, are very prone to add something because it seems too simple. It's hard to believe that something so simple would be more effective than something less complex. So this patient has been using different supplements in addition. And as you can see, the intestinal permeability is at the level of the higher end of the normality. So it is not pathological, it is just somewhat higher than it is expected on his diet. Then we have another transition. This was a relatively healthy person. First, following the carnivore diet in red, then he shifted toward a PKD because he still had some symptoms, and as you can see, the curves are very, very similar. Because, as I told you, intestinal permeability only depends, primarily depends on what you eat and what you do not eat. The difference between the two diets is beyond the intestinal permeability. Here we can see matched blood works. The first one goes for the carnivore period. The second column for the PKD, and as you can see, the glucose and the carbamide, the B1 value was elevated, which came back to the normal range on the PKD. These are very typical alterations, but I show you another very typical example. Again, a patient on a carnivore diet. There are alterations in both directions, including glucose, cholesterol, carbamide, creatinine, amylase, this, and all normalized in the PKD within 4 weeks. So this is a typical constellation of laboratory alterations, and this is indicating eating too much protein, not enough fat, and this is something that will result in negative consequences. Here you can see the physiological differences between ketosis, fat-based metabolism, and the glucose-based metabolism. And here we have to include the carnivore diet because although it might strange at first, but if you are on a carnivore diet, you will be eating meat instead of meat and fat, which means that you will be obtaining energy from protein, amino acids, the so-called glycogenic amino acids. And if you are using the glucose for obtaining energy, it is a much less energy efficient form of using energy. And therefore, you have to do some compensations in order to have enough energy. ATP produced in ketosis is at least 2.6 times higher than obtained from the glucose. And it's obvious that it is also higher than obtained from the protein. There is a difference in the need of oxygen. There's a difference in need for vitamins, also need for antioxidants. There's a huge difference in the need for digestive juices. And there is a big difference in the amount of food you have to eat to be satiated. Need for water also differs. The need for protein is actually the same because it is a biochemical need. And if you are eating and you are in ketosis, there are no storage processes, so no weight gain. If you are following a carnivore diet, especially meat-based diet or very lean meat-based diet, there may be weight gain. And insulin level is low if you are in ketosis, and high, can be high if you are on a carnivore diet or any glucose-based diet. So this is to exemplify how the PKD looks like. So this is a continuum. On one end, we have a diet which is 100% animal meat and fat. On the other end, we have a diet which may be containing 30% of certain vegetables and fruits, but this is only an allowance. This is not a recommendation, and it can be okay for those who are already recovered or relatively healthy. This is still ensuring ketosis if you are eating fat to protein according to 2:1. And here are the chain of the events leading to the development of the autoimmune disease. So first you are eating something that you are not supposed to eat, and these food components will result in junction destruction with the intestine. This is resulting in increased intestinal permeability and also increased general membrane permeability. And then certain food components get into your circulation, and then there is a specific binding between certain macromolecules and certain tissues within the body, and they are forming a complex, and this complex is presenting a danger signal to the immune system, and therefore the immune system is attacking the complex, and so far you are eating this, there will be a continued destruction of the tissues due to the ongoing autoimmune process. And here there are two downstream phenomena to the intestinal permeability. If you do have an intestinal permeability, this may give rise to or may be associated with the permeability of other membranes. For example, if your blood-brain barrier is affected, you may develop on a long-term autoimmune diseases of the central nervous system. And then we have another very important phenomenon, and this is about losing the contact inhibition within tissues. So cell junctions, tight junctions get impaired, and this is giving rise to the impaired communication between cells within the tissue. So in very simple words, the cells are not able to communicate with each other properly, they do not feel each other properly, they do not have a control over each other growth. And this can be resulting in proliferation or endless tissue growth. Thank you for your attention.